three year for the town council, July 13th. Could we have the roll call, please?
Chairman McLaughlin.
Here.
Counselor Chapel.
Here.
Counselor Cogswell.
Here.
Counselor Krillman.
Here.
Counselor Dahlbeck.
Here.
Counselor Jordan.
Here.
And Counselor Pearson.
Here.
Thank you. Could we have the pledge of the flag, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have the minutes of meeting number one, held June 8th, and the minutes of a special meeting number two, held June 30th. I'd like a motion, please.
Move acceptance, Madam Chairman, for both meetings.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor? 7-0. We now have time for citizen discussion of items not on the agenda. Do we have anybody in the audience who would like to address the council? Would you come to the podium and give us your name and address, please?
Thank you. Good evening. Rosemary Reed, 197 Ocean House Road, and I'm here as a private citizen to present to the town council members an idea about enhancing the recycling efforts that we have in Cape Elizabeth at the transfer station, and also as a way to raise money for school and municipal ventures that are generally funded with taxpayers' dollars. This would be an opportunity by my proposal to place a recycling bin out at the transfer station next to the row of recycling bins at their space for people to return beverage containers that have deposits of anywhere from 5 to 15 cents, and to have various groups in town held responsible for these, returning these items to a redemption center, and then being allowed to keep the proceeds of the returnable bottles. And basically, it might be considered a month-long fund drive, a bottle drive. In the past 2 months, there have been two fund drives where people from these organizations go around and collect bottles and cans from homes, and they generally collect about $100 or so dollars on any given day. And my idea was to expand that two ways. One, to make it a longer period where people could donate their returnable bottles and cans, and the other is to take some of the trash that is going through our waste system out of the waste system entirely, because right now people are tossing them very often into the recycling bins. I have given to the town councilors, I hope everyone has one, and I have for the town clerk a copy of my proposal, if there are any questions.
Thank you. Does anybody have questions at this point?
I do want to say I would be responsible for lining up the personnel to do this if the town council does approve me to go any further with this.
I think this is something that we would be advised to have as a regular agenda item next month, most likely.
Okay, then if I could request that this item be put on, I'll come back next month.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilor Pearson, do you have a question?
No, I was just going to move that it be put on the next month's agenda. I think it's a real good idea and a creative and innovative way to enhance both the recycling and fundraising efforts in town, and I move that we put it on next month's agenda.
Do we need a motion for this? We will have it on next month's agenda. I don't think we need a motion. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any other citizens wishing to come to the podium this evening? All right, we'll move to the next item, which is reports and correspondence by the council.
Madam Chairman, I have a little ditty I'd like to report that I see in the National League of Cities Weekly that Councilor Creelman got his picture there for, I believe I could say, I am in the opinion, a job well done with his interest within the National League of Cities, and I hope he continues on. And I have a copy here if you'd like to add it to your collection.
Thank you very much, Billy. It was a very enjoyable meeting representing Cape Elizabeth in Detroit. As you know, we're trying to really create successful national municipal policy that would both help cure the health care crisis in America, but also be particularly cognizant of municipalities who have to pay for that health care. So it's a very, very complicated issue, obviously. We're working very hard with the FAIR Committee of the National League of Cities, which is the crucial committee to help finance this phenomenon, which, as you know, is really the major hurdle and roadblock. So it remains a privilege to represent Cape Elizabeth at this level of national policy making.
Thank you. Quite an honor for the town to have you in that position. We're glad you're enjoying it and representing the town, the nation, actually, so well. Other reports and correspondence from councilors? I do have a couple of things. Strange sound effects, too. Last month, we spoke about the jobs bond that was going to be on the ballot shortly after our June council meeting. As you're all aware, that was approved by the voters. As a result of that approval, the town is receiving a number of different monies that I wanted to make the public aware of. One is a $40,000 grant that we will be discussing later this evening for improvement of the parking lot at the Portland Headlight. Secondly is $33,000 from the Maine Department of Transportation for local roads assistance. And thirdly is approximately $60,000 for projects that will be undertaken directly by the Maine Department of Transportation. And my understanding is that those will include a part of Shore Road down at Pond Cove with the culvert and the headwall, which is where it gets washed over the road in some of our more fierce storms, and some culvert work on Spurlink Avenue. So we appreciate the voters in Cape Elizabeth who supported those issues on the ballot last month. I do have a memo from our assessor, Gerald Daigle, regarding the fiscal year 1993 tax rate. The tax rate is set by the assessor and is set for the fiscal year 1993 at the amount of $17.12 per $1,000 of assessed valuation. Tax bills will be mailed out at the beginning of August. Due dates for taxes are October 7th, 1992, and May 7th, 1993. Towards the end of June, the Council of Governments had its annual dinner, and I'm pleased to say that there were a number of Cape Elizabeth representatives there. Councillor Creelman was able to attend the annual meeting as well. Councillor Jordan was there at the dinner. Our manager, Mr. McGovern, was there, as was I. We had a pleasant evening and some good conversations. And do want to very delightedly announce to the public that the museum at Portland Headlight did open this morning at 10 o'clock. It's open daily, is that right? From 10 to 4, and represents a very wonderful history of the area. It gives a history of navigational aids, the history of Portland Headlight itself, history of the area, including Cape Elizabeth, South Portland, and Portland, and a history of Fort William. There are some fantastic models there. I hope everybody will take an opportunity to go and visit the museum. The admittance fee is $2 for adults and $1 for children. We also do have a very prospering gift shop in conjunction with the museum. I think part of the history that I was reminded of is that Fort William's was bought by the town in
December 1st of 64.
1964. And we have one councillor on this council right now, Councillor Bill Jordan, who was part of that vote to have the town purchase Fort Williams. And I personally, I'm sure I speak for the entire council, are indebted to you for making sure that it is what it is today. Job well done. Thank you. And hope, again, that you can all get a chance to visit the museum. It's one of the real treasures we have in this town. Moving on to our agenda items, we start with a public hearing this evening, the Good Table for a full-time malt, spiritus, and vinous liquor license. Ms. Pizzo, do you have an introduction?
Yes, Thank you very much. You should have received a copy of this renewal application in your packets. Mr. Christopoulos is here this evening. If you have any questions for him, I would recommend that you approve this application.
Thank you. I will open the public hearing. Is there anybody from the public who would like to speak to this? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. I would like a motion, please.
I move the application.
Second.
Thank you. Any comments or questions from councilors? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Our second public hearing of this evening is pertaining to the cable television franchise agreement. Mr. McGovern?
I gave a fairly lengthy presentation of this last month, and it was also a very fine article in the Cape Courier. Would you like me to go into much detail this evening?
No. I don't think we need a lot of detail, maybe a few of the highlights and any changes that have been made.
Yeah, the only changes that have been made since the agreement last came before you was that this final piece was reviewed by the town attorney. He had a number of constructive comments. I forwarded over the comments to Public Cable. All of the changes were made that the town attorney had suggested. There were such things as, in one spot, Public Cable was referred to as a partnership, and another spot a corporation, and it was to get some of those things corrected, and there were comments of a similar ilk. Beyond that, it's a non-exclusive agreement. It is a 15-year agreement. The last agreement provided 15-year renewals. However, this one provides for 10-year renewals. It would continue the cable TV access channel that we now have, the potential for an additional one during the period at whenever the school department would like one. It provides that the cable company would provide us $25,000 for the equipment to maintain the access channels. It provides for a continuation of the 3% franchise fee, only would it be extended to other services in addition to the basic cable. I think those are the highlights, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. We'll open the public hearing. Is there anybody from the public who would like to speak to this? Seeing none, we will close the public hearing. I'd like a motion, please.
Mr. Chairman,
sir.
I move that we approve this franchise agreement for Public Cable Company.
I'll second the motion with one comment, Madam Chairman.
Yes, sir.
The 3% fee, can that be negotiated within the 15 years, or is that locked in for 15 years?
It is. It's locked in. You know, it does depend a little bit on, you know, what the Congress might change in regulatory arrangements. Right now, I believe we're allowed to have an agreement for up to 5%. You know, it could be changed upon mutual agreement of both parties, but it could not unilaterally be changed by either party.
I believe Councilor Jordan is for 10 years rather than 15 with this new agreement.
No, it's 15.
It's going to 15?
Yeah.
The 10-year renewal. Okay, thank you. But it would be different in that it would cover the special channels that now do not have that franchise fee.
Pay-per-view, a percentage of advertising revenue.
Okay.
HBO, Cinemax, Disney.
So this represents more income for the town?
That's right.
Okay. Councilor Cogshaw.
I have, I guess, a question or a clarification that I would like on the special services. Page 12, where it talks about the schools, and since we know that a new school is being proposed to be built, are there any connections in the buildings that are already standing that may be destroyed that will be transferable to this new building? Are we going to have to pay for each new one and not get any credit for what's already in place?
The current middle school, you know, doesn't have, you know, it has access like any other homeowner would to cable, and they do provide that service as part of the agreement. I wouldn't envision where it would be any different under the new agreement.
Connect to the new school. That's the question. If the school department wanted that to be the site of the two-way line,
mm-hmm. And as many connections as they'd want.
I believe there is language in there as far as the number of connections.
Initial connection.
Something I would add.
It just says one to each building, additional will be charged.
Right now, we...
Excuse me, sir, you need to come to the podium. I'm sorry, people can't hear you at home. Thank you. Would you give us your name, please, Jeff?
My name is Jeff Darrow. I'm the vice president at Public Cable. We have a program that we're currently very aggressive with right now. It's called Cable in the Classroom, and we are actively trying to work with the school superintendents and school administration in all of our communities to get as many classrooms and teachers connected to the cable and utilizing the cable in their classrooms. So, but we're doing that more on a demand basis. If a teacher's not interested in incorporating it, we're not wiring that classroom.
Just to... And hopefully there'll be no confusion. This is not Channel 1 that he's referring to.
Right. No commercials.
I realize
no.
that. My other concern was the fact that studio equipment would be provided during the first 10 years. Can we get that done a little sooner than 10 years?
I think the wording that we cleaned up said at any time. So if you'd like whatever the amount that's specified in the franchise on day one, we will do that.
It just says during the first 10 years.
Yeah, with that wording, we went back and forth on it. We have a very clear understanding that we can get it whenever we want, but we're not, you know, they couldn't say you have to do it within 12 months or it's gone. You know, it would be a continuing credit for it. But,
so it's on demand and not
that's right.
at the discretion of the company.
That's right.
Just wondering, do they have the final?
Yes, they do.
Doesn't that say at any time? During the first 10 years?
During the first 10 years, but it just seems okay. like a long time. That was,
it's 629 draft.
Okay.
Last one.
Yeah.
Just say it any time.
That's it.
Thank you. Councilor Creelman?
Yes, Mr. Darrell, you really answered all of my questions last month on the technicalities of this particular contract. I just did want to make a couple of comments, though. The first is that I think, in general, it's unfortunate that the cable industry is moving, it seems, yearly in this exponential fashion of the pay-per-view phenomenon and really taking what had been, in the past, basic programs and of course, forcing them onto the cable. I'm thinking, in particular, of Red Sox baseball games as just an illustration. Each year, there are more and more of these games that are put on the NESN network and taken off of the typical CBS, NBC, this type of thing. I don't have the numbers, but it clearly appears to me over the last 5 years there are fewer and fewer, you know, of the 162 games being telecast where anyone can basically see the game. And my fear is that, you know, over time it's going to go from the cable to NESN to pay-per-view and sort of mom's apple pie, and baseball is going to go down the tubes unless you have extra funds to take care of that. That's one of my philosophical concerns. The other thing is, and I'll never understand this, I ordered the NESN network for a short period of time for the sole reason of watching Boston College football games. I called up the company and they said, well, you know, we have these games live, and being a diehard fan, I ordered the NESN network. Come to find out that the Boston College football games are replayed Sunday night, when the game is actually live Saturday afternoon. Everyone's read the score, they know what's happened, they've seen the news clips, and the thing comes on Sunday night. I'll never understand the wisdom behind this particular decision. Could you enlighten me?
Well, let me address the first issue, if I could. We also share the same concerns about the migration of programming to pay-per-view. One of the problems, you've got to remember the structure of the industry. We are really the carrier or distributor, if you will. We negotiate contracts with these programmers. One of the things that we're finding is that the sports leagues especially are very aggressively getting involved in our industry and restricting our access to the programming. They are dictating the way we are having to market the programming. So, and now Congress is working on restricting our ability to assume some ownership so we can maintain the control and keep it on basic cable, if you will. So we have the very same concerns. Ultimately, if everything is on pay-per-view, that we don't see that as positive for our industry. So it's an ongoing battle, but it's a matter of who owns the product. And we do not own the sports product, especially. Regarding Boston College, I can't speak to that specifically. You said you spoke to Nesson?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I called up that special extra payment for the cable, the Nesson network there, mm-hmm. again, for the sole purpose of watching BC football live, and I never heard of such a thing to see the game a day and a half later. Mm-hmm. Didn't make much sense.
Our contract with Nesson says basically that we have no say in the programming rights that they go out and procure and the way they program their network. We have absolutely no say in that, and that we are mandated to carry that network in whatever form they put it in. So, again, we can share those kinds of concerns with Nesson, and we will do that. But there's very little we can do.
Appreciate that.
Did BC have a winning season?
Well, that's irrelevant. That's the issue.
Excuse me. Couldn't resist, however. Do we have any more questions of Mr. Darrell while he's gracious?
Well, I wouldn't dare.
Thank you very much, Jeff. I think you're off the hot seat in a few minutes. Councilor Jordan.
Well, I thought through my mind that I just hope the town attorneys review this, because to me, you're talking 15, 20, 25 years here, and things can happen down the road, and I hope the language is in there that other things can be negotiated on the way through those 25 years. Now, I probably won't be here to see it through, and there may be some other people will be missing, and I just hope the language is adequate. I know you mentioned a minute ago, the manager, about that it is understood. Well, something that's understood here now, I don't think it will be understood with seven new members sitting here.
Yeah.
So I just hope it is adequate, that's all.
We also saved the videotapes of all of these meetings and have ever since the first time they were broadcast. And we've been very careful a number of times at these meetings when companies make certain representations that we have them on the record. That's the case in this instance, both last month and this month as well.
Valid concern.
Thank you.
Valid concern. Any other comments? I do want to put forth a thank you to our cable TV committee that is chaired by Jack Bates. And that committee did have a subcommittee who helped with these negotiations. That included Bill Hosmer, Howard Krantman, Alistair McVicker, and our TV coordinator, Harry Proudman. I thank all of you for helping us to bring this to fruition. You did a good job, gentlemen. Okay, we do have a motion in a second. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item 25 is to consider the adoption of the Town Council goals for 1992-1993 and take any necessary action. It may not be real evident to the public that the Council went through a different process this year for establishing goals. In the past, we've had more or less of a laundry list and gotten to the point where we had prioritized it and grouped it a bit. This year, we ended up with what I thought was six and became seven goals here that the manager has put together for us from a workshop we had a couple of weeks ago. I would like to read these goals, and then we can have any motion and discussion. Cable Elizabeth Town Council goals for 1992-1993. Number one, adopt a vision statement for the community. Number two, continue to improve communications between the Town Council and its boards, between the Town Council and the school board, between the Town Council and legislators, and between the town and its citizens. Number three, to develop an enhanced long-range capital improvement plan, including a municipal and school projects, and including a long-range financial plan. Number four, to improve the police and fire facilities as recommended by the Municipal Facilities Committee. Number five, maintain rideability of all arterial and collector roads in excellent condition. Number six, maintain and procure open space, including to expand and improve open space, and I believe the green belt is in there, to resolve the Thomas Jordan Trust, and number seven, to adopt a town center plan. So that is what the council came up with in a workshop. I thank the manager for putting it in black and white for us after those discussions that evening. I would like a motion and then any discussion, please.
I would move acceptance of the goals.
Second.
Thank you. Do we have any discussion on the goals? Counselor Jordan?
I have just one question, and I guess it's a matter of interpretation. Number five, excellent condition. My interpretation of excellent might be different than somebody else's, and I think it's pretty hard to call them all excellent. I would rather see the word good there. Good road, good condition, not excellent condition. I interpret that a little bit too much.
Mr. Chairman.
Counselor Chairman.
When you make a goal, Mr. Counselor Jordan, you make it just as high up in the air as you can and hope you'll get there someday. So we don't want to just say good, because then the highway department would stop at good. We got to make it excellent and keep them going forever.
Thanks for your interpretation, Counselor. But I don't quite interpret it that way.
Counselor Dahlbeck, I believe this was one of your goals. Do you want to give your interpretation? Are you satisfied with the wording?
Well, I am not too sure how you define excellent or even how you define good. But I would just as soon leave it at excellent. I think there are certain roads in the Cape that are primary travel roads, and those roads should be in good, passable shape. Maybe that's right. I'm not too sure exactly how you would define excellent. And, somebody might be able to come up with a better definition. I could say good enough shape for me to ride on the shoulder of the road on my bicycle.
Just if I may help out, if we change the syntax of the sentence, it might make it better. Maintain excellent rideability of all arterial and collector roads, because what you're really talking about is the rideability and not necessarily...
I buy that.
I didn't like that word.
I like that.
Excuse us while we have our grammar corrections here. Councilor Cosgrove. On number six, as I said when I was reading them, we have expand and improve open space and the green belt, is my recollection.
Right.
Okay. I was delighted, actually, when we came out of that workshop to find that the two challenges I had put forth when I spoke after being put in this position last month became two of the goals, adopting a vision statement for the community and working on communications. And these are ways I hope we can have citizen input and participation. We all know how valuable that has been and always will be to this community. That's what makes us as special as we are a lot of the times. Any other comments? Okay, all those in favor of these goals as presented? Thank you, 7-0. Item number 26 is to consider approving a project to develop a pavement management plan and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, this item was placed on your agenda to follow the previous item. One of your goals of this year is to maintain excellent rideability of all arterial and collector roads. And, yeah, you know, an awful lot of that is a very subjective consideration. And It's felt that we ought to have objective criteria, not subjective criteria, for evaluating all of our different roads. And a manner in which to do that is through a pavement management study. And Bob Malley, the Director of Public Works, is here to explain exactly what a pavement management study is and how it would be used as a resource.
Thank you.
As Mike said, developing our pavement plan this year, it became apparent that we needed to update our existing plan. We do have a plan in effect right now that was done in conjunction with the Council of Governments back in 1987. And what they basically did then was take various measurements at intervals along the road, measure cracking, measure distortion, which is a measure of rutting or crown realignment, and also a level of patching at that particular interval. And you come up with a number or a rating system for that, and run it through a computer model, and you end up with a rating on that particular road. And it's very helpful for purposes of setting up the program to have a number to go by, so to speak. We can look at roads, and I can drive over them, and we do all day long and say, yes, this needs it, this one doesn't. But if you have a system intact, I think it's helpful for both me and for you, and also for the planning board to go by, to have an inventory and category of the roads, and have conditions and work history on this plan that they can go by. So it would be a matter of obtaining new information on the roads, remeasuring at various intervals again. And the plan that I'm proposing is that we take intervals every quarter of a mile. And if a road is not a quarter of a mile long, there'll be at least two intervals on that where, again, cracking is measured and distortion and patching. And it's a plan that can be updated. And what is recommended is usually about every 2 years is to do an update because, again, you have deteriorating conditions through the roads. You have paving that takes place, road improvements. So the last plan that was done, we've done a lot of paving and road improvements since then. So now it's basically obsolete, and we need to get some more information.
Thank you. Do you have any questions of Mr. Mallon? Councilor Dalbeck?
Bob, first, what roads would you include in this?
We would do every road in town, and I would propose doing the state roads also, because eventually they're going to come under our control and jurisdiction, so we really might as well do them now rather than have them left off if they are turned back to us at some point. So basically you're looking at
all roads,
all roads, all side roads, all arterials, collector roads, everything.
Looking at the Yarmouth approach, is that getting on the expensive side to have to do them all? Can you do that for that amount of money?
Yes, we can. Talk with the engineering firm that did Yarmouth's proposal, and they felt very comfortable with that dollar figure that they could perform the work and obtain the information that we want to obtain. So they had no problem with it. And we have about 57 miles of roads, so we're very close to Yarmouth. Hmm.
Second question, the $8,300, you're taking it out of a roadway and drainage improvement account. Is this going to preclude something important being done that money was budgeted for in that account?
No, it shouldn't.
Thank you.
Councilor Cogshaw?
Any questions?
Answer the questions.
Councilor
Jordan?
My question is to Bob, how often do you have to do this?
Should do it about every 2 years. That's what they recommend is updating. Again, that takes into account your paving programs over that two-year period. And also if you have changing conditions within the road base or road surface. What you do is you go back in 2 years and you measure the same spot again. So you're not measuring a different spot. You're going back to that same location and seeing if the deterioration has increased, gotten better, stayed the same. So you're really taking that visual and physical measurement on that same location every 2 years. You can do it every three, but that's what most of them are doing is two.
Can it be an in-house project after you once do it?
I've talked with a number of directors, some that have done it in-house and some that have contracted out for it, and they felt that they got a better product by having an impartial person or third party look at their roads, and it's also a big time commitment to go out and physically do this work. And talking to one that did, said that if he had to do it again, he would have had an engineering firm do it for them. And I think it helps to get a fresh look at the roads. I think, I mean, not to say that I don't, but if you go over the same road day after day, I think someone that hasn't been on it may look at it differently and maybe pick something up and see something different or look at it differently.
Councilor Krillman?
I had the same questions that my colleague Mr. Dalbeck had with regard to this program. You know, I know we're in an era of professionalism in every conceivable field. And if my memory serves me, now the study of our roads that had been done prior to COG study was done by our town manager when he was an intern. No?
No, I was a graduate student. It was a project.
Graduate student. Now, are we suggesting that work was unprofessional? when that was done, or?
No, not at all. Actually, the technology and has changed considerably. And this study just doesn't give you a rating. It gives you projected deterioration rates on a five-year period. So you can see that if you do nothing to this road, how the rating will drop. It takes into account traffic volumes on roads. So that factors into the type of maintenance that's involved. So it's not just a matter of a pavement rating, but again, traffic is included, and there's a number of factors that probably weren't in the first plan done by the manager.
You use the word yourself, Bob, this plan would be helpful. I mean, is it crucial in terms of our 57 miles of roads? I ask that in a little bit of cynicism, because I must confess, I mean, $8,000, even though nothing may be postponed, I mean, if you take that $8,000 and you put it into McAdam, I mean, it has to be a certain number more feet of roads that we could do. I mean, if we had an opportunity to in-house, you know, drop a plunger every quarter of a mile and see if the thing's falling apart or not. It just, you know, again, educate me and convince me that we're not just jumping on the bandwagon of, you know, some towns in the local area that, you know, have bought into this, you know, phenomenon. I want to be convinced that this $8,000 is going to be well spent. And if an 87 COG did it, are they, I mean, in joint purchase type of stories, are they not doing it anymore?
No, they're not.
They're not doing it anymore. So we can't get a better deal by buying into a grand plan or something.
No, and that's what the Yarmouth did. They worked with Westbrook and Scarborough and did it jointly to save some money then. But I think it helps in the decision-making process when you pave a road or when you do road improvements. You cannot simply say that, you know, we're doing it because for political reasons or for whatever reasons. There's a scientific method to why we do this, and if someone questioned a decision of why we paved a road or did road improvements, you could point to them and say, well, you know, we did some field work and this is the rating for this road. It requires some form of rehabilitation. So I think it would help me in the decision-making process for which roads get done and which roads don't. I think it helps with the methodology of, you know, how we set up a paving program and how you set up a roadway improvements plan.
Remind me about the other events that are funded out of the roadway and drainage improvement account.
All your paving is funded from that. All your major road and drainage projects are funded from that. If you choose to look at signalization, that would be funded from that account also. So it's really the total account for all our road improvements.
And remind me, if you have offhand, the amount of money we budgeted in that account last year?
$150,000 with $50,000 earmarked for paving.
One comment I would like to make, that I think, you know, you have to look at it, you know, it will be a resource in certain respects for the council, a resource in certain respects for the manager, and most particularly a resource for the department itself. For me, one of the greatest assets of it would tie into the goal relating to the long-range financial plan. You know, we really need to know how much we ought to be investing each year in roads. I think the best thing of the unprofessional study that was done when I was a graduate student was the fact that it really showed how much that we needed to invest at that point because of the recession of the early 1980s. Our investment in paving had gone to about $20,000 a year, and that study at that time showed that we should have been investing around $200,000 a year if we were to keep up with it and to provide and do the maintenance on roads when it ought to be done, rather than to wait later when you have to do much more expensive roadway work. And, you know, from a management point of view, you know, I think it'd be an excellent resource for the council to see, for myself as the manager, to see what we ought to be making for an investment.
Councilor, what do you think in 2 or 3 years your update would cost?
Roughly, they figure about a quarter of the cost, a quarter to a third of the original cost. Once you have the original field data, the road measurements, it's just a matter of going back to those intervals and doing the updated measurements on cracking. But it's not another $8,000 investment in 2 years or 3 years.
Okay. Thank
Counselor Jordan.
My only point is, since 2 years is a short time to come back and review some of them, I'm in favor of a 5-year project like you had before, but to come back and review all the roads again in 2 years, but I suppose if you're going to get it done for a couple of grand, it's probably worth looking at, but I just, if they said, he said a quarter of it, so a quarter of 8,000, you're doing it for a couple of grand, to me that's pretty cheap to have somebody come professionally and overlook all the roads in the town, so I'll keep that figure in the back of my mind.
And that's your choice, too. I mean, you can choose not to do 2, you can do 3 or 4. It's really a council decision, but that's what they have recommended, and that's what other towns in Falmouth right now is doing an update. They did their first one 2 years ago, so just to give you an idea.
Councilor Cogshaw.
Could we use this as a type of privatization of a particular service?
That's in essence what's being proposed here.
Certainly sounds it.
You can't convince me that it's classy.
It's supposed to warm the cockles of your heart, Councilor Jordan. I also appreciated Councilor Chappell's question about the cost of the updates. I was getting concerned we might be buying into 8,000 every couple of years, which I know you would meet resistance with. You knew you'd meet resistance with that. Are there any other, do you know of any other towns who are considering something like this right now, who we could piggyback with?
Not at the present time, but I can put some feelers out and find out, you know, if there's any other interest out there. But all of our neighbors are presently doing it. I don't know what South Portland has for a plan, but they're the only ones that I didn't talk to. But pretty much everybody around us has a plan. And Westport participated back in the COG study, so they did an update. And I believe Scarborough did, too. So there was 5 of us that participated in that study in 87. So it's not something new and different. It's been out there for a while.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Creelman?
Is there any possibility, Bob, you've identified this Casey and Godfrey firm, would we put this project out to bid and get several people competing for the job? Or
there's another organization or engineering firm that does it called Squaw Bay. They do a visual type of inspection. It's not a hands-on where they get out and measure the cracking. It's more of a drive-by. And I really didn't feel that that would be worth the investment to do that. That we really needed some physical data that was obtained by getting out of the truck and measuring rather than simply just driving by. Yarmouth, again, looked at both companies and thought that this would be the best process for them.
Yeah, Casey and Godfrey themselves both used to work for MDOT and did this for MDOT. And you talk about privatization. It's the perfect example. They found out that life would be greener outside of state government, and Ms. Casey and Mr. Godfrey set up their own firm and are now doing it privately.
Any other questions for Mr. Mallon?
Just one comment. I think outside of state government is a little bit different than outside of
Thank you very much, Bill. Okay, I'd like a motion from the council, please.
I move acceptance of the project.
Second.
Any other council discussion? Okay, all those in favor? All those opposed? 6-1, Creelman opposed. Thank you. Item number 27 is to consider approving additional funding to continue to have the town represented before the Maine Public Utilities Commission in the Portland Water District rate case and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, Madam Chairman. When the PUC decided the Portland Water District rate case, they put off an awful lot of the decision-making until the second phase of the case, which is due to come up this fall. As the council's aware, the first phase of the case was one that was quite successful for the towns, although there's still a long way to go. The initial savings that we calculated from the first part of the rate case to ratepayers within Cape Elizabeth to the town itself, into the town itself, amounted to about $180,000. In addition, if you, again, look at the life cycle cost of that, you look at over 10 years, we probably saved the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, and they saved themselves from having signed a petition, nearly $750,000 over a 10-year period. For that, the town had invested $8,400. What I'm suggesting at this point is, in order to continue advocating for the PUC, that the town invest an additional $8,400 with the hope that, you know, if we got half again back the return that we got on the first investment, would be, you know, the best investment that anyone could get in any market today. So I would recommend that you allocate $8,400 from undesignated surplus to allow continued advocacy before the PUC, and that the appropriation be contingent upon a majority of towns continuing to participate financially, and that the same funding formula will be used, be utilized that was utilized for the first investment in the rate case.
Thank you very much. Could I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Discussion?
Councilor Cottrell?
Councilor Jordan?
My only question is that it, is this going to be as much of a project as the previous one, do you feel? We had put $8,400 in before, and we went as a raise and done it all, you know. Do we need $8,400 again?
Yeah, the estimate is a $40,000 cost for the whole process, which is 20% below the estimate for the first phase. Two things. I'm not convinced that it will be 20% less. And second, if you look at the wording of this, I'm not convinced that every single town that participated in the last time may necessarily participate this time, although each of the managers from those communities, when we met for lunch about 4 weeks ago on the issue, did feel that their councils would probably be inclined, based on comments that the councilors had made as a result of the first rate case. But I had a little bit of concern with Standish because they have some different relationships with the district than the rest of us do. That's why I didn't phrase it with unanimity. And then, you know, a lot of the councils have changed, you never know. But, you know, the key is that Scarborough stay in, and there's every indication that they plan to, that Falmouth stays in, the Cape, and Wyndham and Cumberland. Every indication I get is that they will be staying with us.
Are they going to stay in at the same rate?
Yeah, well, your proposal is here contingent that the allocation of the cost be based on the same funding formula that it was last time, under the motion that's on the floor. So there may be a town missing from it, but it would be the same formula, weighted two times for water usage and one time for hydrant cost.
Thank you. Councilor Creelman?
Well, again, I know you've got to spend money to make money, and I think we've apparently done that in the town of Cape Elizabeth with the savings we've appreciated. Do you have any sense that this lengthy lawyer's battle is going to go into a phase three, though? I mean, you're going to come back again 6 months and another 8,000, another 8,000?
My sense is that an awful lot of the more issues, my grammar's getting terrible. Quite a few more issues were resolved in the second phase, but I'd be surprised if they're all resolved. But, you know, from what I read in local papers and what I pick up otherwise, the PUC commission is definitely hearing the towns. And there was a very strong article in last week's Westbrook American that the district took strong exception to in terms of some characterizations that the PUC staff had given to some material that was supplied by the district. And my sense is, and you know, particularly from what was debated when they met back in April and actually debated the rate case, my sense is that the commission really is interested in looking at fair rates.
And you say here in your request for the appropriation, it would be contingent upon a majority of towns continuing to participate. Now, majority would be 4 out of 7. Is that correct? So if 4 out of 7 said yes and 3 said no, would we then have to change the appropriation to come up to the 40,000?
I think, you know, if it was that slim, you know, again, it would depend on the towns, but you know, if Scarborough, Falmouth, and Cape Elizabeth, and either Windham or Cumberland don't hold in this, you know, we'd have to rethink the whole thing. But as I said, I have every reason to think it's still being.
So we would cap it at 8,400, and you're assuming that that number says that 6 of the 7 are going to do it?
That's right.
Okay, thank you.
But, you know, if Scarborough fell out, that wouldn't do it, but just, you know, Scarborough is very, very supportive. Continued effort from every indication I've got from over there.
Councilor Jordan?
Well, I would just like to say that I don't think we should drop out now. I think we've got them going down the road. We've got them thinking a change is going to be made, and we will be made next year or the year after. But it just bothers me to think back the years back when they were before the town and wanted to tie these dead ends in to help the water pressure. Some dead ends, and they had quite a project that went on all back then, and I remember it. And now they turn around and feel that it isn't a long-term water system, which I wholly disagree with. I think the way they tied in the cities and the towns, that it's a one system, and I just hope we can keep going on it.
Thank you, Councilor. Well said. Any other comments?
I agree wholeheartedly with what you've said, Councilor Jordan. I think perhaps in retrospect, some of the towns may be wondering why they didn't start questioning these fees a good while ago, but I'm glad we've started it now, and I really do agree that we need to keep going, and this is not money being poured down the drain at all. This is money being well spent, and as the manager said, it's one of the best returns on our money we're going to be seeing. Absolutely convinced of that. Okay, we do have a motion. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 28 is to consider setting a public hearing on the state's offer to substantially fund traffic signals on Route 77 at Spurwink Avenue and at Shore Road, at the Shore Road Scott Dyer Road intersection, and to take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, the state has sent us essentially a grant offer whereby they would pick up, along with the federal government, approximately 82.5% of the cost. There's a mix. It's 15% for the installation and all of that, but we have to pick up as the local 20% of the preliminary and planning cost. Our share for both lights would be $9,600. It would come out of the same fund that you just assessed, the roadway drainage account, with the pavement management study. The state plans to have bid invitations for this project in February of 1993. The signals would be traffic activated, which means that Route 77 would be green all the time, except when a vehicle came into one of the intersecting streets. Where it would cause the light to flip on to red on Route 77 and green in the other lanes. You see a lot of these traffic activated lights throughout the city of Portland. There aren't too many in South Portland. My plan would be, if you set this public hearing next month, is to do a number of things. One is to have the town planner present to update you on some of the projects that were done near these two intersections and what the traffic studies have shown. Second, to have Bill Bray present, who is the traffic engineer for the city of Portland by full time. He'd be doing this on the side on a contractual basis, and he can explain in detail traffic demand levels and all the technical terms that I'm not too comfortable explaining. And he could also answer specific questions that members of the public might have on the intimate details of how traffic lights work. In addition to that, there would need to be some consideration given on whether or not the town would like to have walk lights at either intersection, particularly the one here may be a concern with the schools so close and with the thought that, you know, the town center might be want to become much more pedestrian-oriented than it now is in the whole thrust from the federal government of intermodal transportation improvements, that you ought not to be just looking at roads, but other improvements as well. So, you know, also between now and next month, you know, if anyone has any specific comments that they'd like to make at next month's hearing or whatever, on if there were lights, you know, do they want them on black post or silver post or, you know, all those type things. So those can all still be discussed with MDOT. So I would recommend, now that we have the proposed memorandum of understanding from the Maine Department of Transportation, to set a public hearing for your August 10th meeting.
Thank you. Could I have a motion, please?
I move the public hearing.
Second. August 10th, 1992, 7:30 p.m.
Thank you. You won't get used to it. That's like you can count the dollar.
Is this an all or nothing, both intersections, or nothing, or
no,
still open to just one?
That's right.
Councilor Crowley?
You know, there are so many questions that come to mind when you think about signaling these two particular intersections. This is such a hot issue in the town. You know, I mean, to many people it represents, you know, going down the tubes and we're joining the major cities now that we've got a red, white, and whatever, no, green, red, and yellow.
We have new colors.
Light. Just a couple of thoughts. One is that I think it's unfortunate that August 10th, I mean, is a public hearing. I think a lot of people are out of town. A lot of people go away during the summer. A lot of people are on vacation. I think it's going to be tough to get a lot of people there. And I would hope that this is such an important issue that that would be the first of at least a couple of public hearings on the issue. I mean, one is to kind of put it out to the public and say, this is a possibility that we're considering. You know, come and tell us what your opinions are. Call us, write us in the meantime. But that, you know, after Labor Day certainly would be another shot at, you know, getting a number of people again that might not be around August 10th. And quite honestly, I think the council, as a group of seven people, need to, at some point, perhaps between now and that second public hearing, really sit down for a workshop with the people who would be doing this. Because so Sam Townsend has sent me a letter saying that absolutely, you know, they ought to be activated, but there ought to be periods of time during the year when, you know, they ought to be flashing yellow from midnight to 5 in the morning. I mean, is there any sense to have cars activated? Can you get a timer to have yellow flashing? There just are so many permutations, and I'm far from an expert in this area. I would like to at least have some opportunity for the council to have a workshop before we actually took a vote on taking this this money on behalf of Cape Elizabeth.
Just, if I may, I think the one common substantive that you made in relation to the direct issue is whether or not it could be, you know, on an off days during late hours, and certainly it can be. I don't have any problem if you have one or two hearings. My sense, though, is that, you know, I would prefer that you have everything out in the public, and, you know, if you want to have a second hearing, fine, maybe have one next month and get all those issues out, and then if you want to delay to the next month, fine. But I think by bringing it to a workshop, there's, you know, the aisle is closely watched, and, you know, if you do feel that it's an issue of broad public interest, then, you know, let the public fully see on TV and everything the full brunt of the decision making.
I think a lot of the questions we would want to ask in the workshop, we could ask, it would be appropriate to ask of the people we would have attending the public hearing, experts attending the public hearing who'd have the factual information for us, rather than having them come out a couple of times.
But I think they could also probably, in their vast array of different permutations, say, well, look, here are five or six ways to do it, and these are exactly where these are located in the greater Portland area. Go drive out and take a look at it and really get a feel for the geography of how it would work, because we'll have to realign that whole intersection at Pond Cove and Shore Road. That the whole road is all cockeyed now. We'd have to get major tractors in there and realign the whole thing. So just seems to me it's a big task to throw out, you know, in a formal setting like this without us doing some homework behind the scenes and kind of seeing what exactly it would be in the real live world.
I ask one question.
It's the realignment before that. We have information on that.
Yep.
In a June 1st, 1990 report out of T.Y. Lynn. It doesn't show a whole lot of major reconstruction, but it is reconstruction. And that, in fact, is not included in the money being shared with the state. That was my understanding when I discussed it with Mr. McGovern this afternoon. That was something else.
Yeah, the T.Y. Lynn study in 1990 is not the MDOT study that's installing the lights. They do their own design.
Okay. So we would need to know how much it would vary from what we've seen already. Yeah, as you and I discussed this afternoon, there are some more pieces of factual information that I'm sure all the council is going to need before it can feel comfortable making any kind of decision on this. And, if we want to do that in workshop, we can. I do think there's a lot of value in having that kind of information done publicly, because those are kind of some of the things that the public will get up and only have partial information, and it can start a real scare campaign going, which none of us want. We want this decision based on facts, and if the public has the facts at the same time the council does, I think that's a benefit to everybody. And Councilor Coggeshall.
I agree with Councilor Creelman that we shouldn't make a final decision next month, that we should have a second public hearing in September, because it has been, even among some of the councilors at different times, a very hot issue. I think the more we think about it and the more the public has a chance to have input, the better decision we'll make.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Dalbeck?
I would basically go along with that. I would like to see us get a lot of input at the meeting in August, and then be in a position for the town manager and his staff to make a specific proposal. I'm hesitant about the council getting into a workshop and becoming professional engineers in this whole thing themselves. I think we're going over our heads if we do that. But I would like to see a specific proposal after all the input before we vote. So I'd like to vote in September.
Okay. Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
I agree with Councilor Dalbeck and Councilor Creelman has said that I think we should have two public hearings on this issue. But I just hope the first public hearing generates enough interest to get the people out that are interested in it and are available, and to throw out their concerns and not wait until September when the vote comes in. And we would be ready to vote on it. Now, my question to the manager is, the time schedule is adequate so we can vote in September?
Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, the bid advertisement is not due to go up for a while. So once the council makes the decision, there'll still be plenty of time for MDOT to do the final engineering and bid specs. They haven't given us a firm deadline as of yet.
So the possibility it could be next year's budget?
If they're doing bids in February, it would be late in the year. And it'd be taken out of the roadway drainage account with the existing appropriated funds. We wouldn't be looking for additional funds.
That's a pretty good fund.
Well, you appropriated sufficient resources in it to give you some discretionary decision making.
Councilor Coggeshall.
We also have to keep in mind that there is a very industrious group who's conducting a study at the town center. I'm sure they are considering that whole issue and we probably would need some input from that group as well, to see what their vision, how their vision's developing.
And we communicate that to...
I'll give the chairman a call and see if he will...
Hopefully we'll have a representative of that group at our August public hearing. I think we will.
I had one question, and it was actually, Lee, will the state send someone to such a hearing, if we asked?
What do you mean, a dual role?
Yeah, would you be willing to, this is Lee Chase.
Could you come to the...
Who is the traffic engineer for the Maine Department of Transportation for District Number 6?
Yes.
And it was...
I'm just a camera.
This doesn't mean if you work the cameras that you have to come talk, folks. I don't want to lose any camera operators.
Would MDOT send someone to the meeting next week, next month, if we asked?
Definitely.
Okay.
Hopefully it isn't me. I don't know if I'd have to screen conflict of interest, I don't know. It most likely would be me unless we can get somebody out of Augusta.
Okay, I'll talk to him after the meeting. So I didn't want to publicly say that we'd have someone from MDOT here with us.
Definitely somebody would be here.
Okay, so we'll try. Yeah, so you'll also, the public will have the chance to ask them questions. Thank you, Lee. Sorry to put you on the spot.
Thank you. Other comments?
Madam Chairman, we'll try to bring this up tomorrow night at the Town Center Planning Committee. I know we're on sidewalks and striping right now, and we have discussed both of the, just this one here in our committee at this corner, not the other one. And there's been a decision made by the 9 committee members, so I think we'll have that for you tomorrow night, too. I won't tell you what it is tonight.
That's terrific. I think the walk light situation might fit in nicely with your sidewalk discussion.
But it has been discussed, and it is in the plan.
Very good. That'll certainly help the entire council. Glad we have 2 representatives on that committee. Thank you. Any other comments? Okay, we do have a motion to set this to public hearing on August 10th. Okay. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 29 is to consider a technical amendment to the construction code relating to the floodplain map revisions and to take any necessary action. Mr. McCumber.
Yes, FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, does floodplain maps for every community, I guess, in the nation, and occasionally they do revisions. And the ordinance states that under our flood hazard ordinance that it's a certain map, and if they keep sending revisions, you get into problems all the time of, are you using the right map? So the town planner and the code enforcement officer discussed this, and we recommend to you that you provide an amendment to the code of ordinances, which identifies the original map, but adds a clause that in subsequent map revisions there too. Would be the official map. We can't change the maps anyway. The FEMA does them. So this would automatically ensure that we're in compliance with the regulations and people can still continue to get flood insurance.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 30 is to consider reviewing proposed plans for the reconstruction of the Portland Headlight parking lot and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern? We're going to have a tour.
Just very briefly, the councilors went down to look at the museum early this evening and looked at the parking lot and looked at the staff. But for those who aren't familiar with the specific proposal, this is the driveway that comes into the land immediately adjacent to Portland Headlight. For anyone who drives down there, particularly during the weekend, you'll note that it's really kind of a mess to figure out where to back, where to park, and it's very difficult. It's proposed because this is a terminus spot for so many people to come into the park and just loop in and loop out, that we have a circular turnaround there. There'd be a small berm in the middle with some low planting. In addition, there'd be a berm as you come in the entranceway that would have a very stylish sign, that's the word I'm looking for, that identifies it as Portland Headlight. And essentially, it would be much more aesthetically pleasing as you win, as well as being an enhancement for safety. It is in keeping with the Fort Williams Master Plan that was prepared a couple of years ago and approved by the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. That plan provides for the development of a large central parking lot up in the vicinity as you go down over the hill before you turn left to go to the lighthouse, which would be straight ahead. That is currently under construction by the National Guard, and at least you'll see during the month of August some very heavy bulldozing, some very heavy action of construction there. This parking lot, there'd be a couple of handicap spots that'd actually be fewer spaces, and I think everyone recognizes that the parking is totally inadequate there now. The issue is you want to spread it out over the field that was permanently dedicated as open space by the town council back in 1975 when it accepted the Fort Williams plan, or do you want to put the parking somewhere else? The master plan contemplates putting it here and having a circular motion to ease traffic flow as well as to make it much more aesthetically pleasing than it now is. This did go to the jobs bond when the application was submitted. The town did receive a grant for $40,000, which does need to be matched. It's the administration's proposal the matching funds come $20,000 from the capital project for the Portland Headlight Fund, which would eventually be paid back through museum admissions and gift shop proceeds, profits, and that the remaining $20,000 come from the Fort Williams Improvement Account. I did send a memo to the Fort Williams Advisory Commission last week, informing them, last Tuesday, informing them that this was being considered, and asked them to call me if they had any questions or concerns. I personally did not hear from any of them on this particular issue. They have reviewed this plan with Tom Emery, the landscape architect, and did like what they saw. They're meeting again with Tom at their next meeting, which I believe is this Thursday. It's the 16th, I believe. So do you want me to stand here or go back to my seat? Does anyone have any questions?
If you'll stay there. Are there any questions from councilors? All Mr. McGovern is there. Councilor Dalbeck?
How many parking spaces are you looking for down there? And what's the distance to the other parking lot?
Yeah, there'd be a dozen spaces along the side where the now are that would face out towards the field, mm-hmm. towards Delano Park. There would be four parking spaces on the other side of the circle that would be designated for the folks living in the apartment at Portland Headlight, as well as for gift shop museum personnel. There would be room for up to three buses along the perimeter of the circle. And the rest of the folks, after this overflow, would have to park at this right near the bottom of the hill, right before you make the turn to the lighthouse. It's a fairly short walk, but then again, you know, it's more of a walk than people are used to. I know from my own experience visiting, I do as much traveling as I can afford, and probably too much. You know, I think there are very few places where you go to a site such as this and you park on top of it. You know, you go to Lexington and Concord, you go, you know, all the many places, and, you know, most places that you go, you have to park a little distance. I think this is a compromise to that. There is some parking provided there, but not enough certainly to meet all the need. The other thing, I've been spending an awful lot of time down at the lighthouse with the museum development project, almost there every day for the last few weeks and several times a week over the last few months. And what I have found, interestingly enough, is that an awful lot of people park in this lot to use the rest of the park. Because you, if you count, even today, I was looking at, you count the people in the immediate vicinity of on the lighthouse grounds, along the fence, taking pictures back in the gift shop, and you can't account for half the cars that are there. And what it is, a lot of people go in and they just stop at the last parking lot. And you know, I think we need to do something to encourage, I'm not sure exactly what it is, the folks who
you know, aren't going to the museum, gift shop, and the immediate lighthouse area to try to park in the rest of the park. And that might be, you know, when this goes in, maybe limiting it to, you know, 45-minute parking, half-hour parking, something like that.
Councilor Cole.
Michael, would this plan satisfy the tenets of the American Disabilities Act with regard to handicap spaces?
Yes, it would. That's all been reviewed by Tom Emery, the landscape architect. One thing that the Fort Williams Committee really wanted, and was one of the changes that was made, is that there still will be one parking spot. There will be a handicap spot that you could sit right on top of the fence that's now there. It's the one open spot between the garden shed and the edge of the field, where you can just sit there for those that can't get out of their vehicle at all and just want to sit and look at the ocean. Yeah, I noticed way up near the CD bunker the last few weeks, there's another bus there with, must be coming from some housing for the elderly, a nursing home or whatever, and there's been a lot of people that use that spot to pull out and enjoy the view of the ship channel.
Any other questions while Mr. McGovern is at the drawing? Councilor Jordan.
I like the plan pretty much as far as the making the circle there with the shrubbery and what have you in the middle, but I still aren't convinced that we put the parking up in the other side of the bunker that's still there. I think it's asking too much for people to walk down there, because the other ones can be taken up by somebody just sightseeing, looking at the water and what have you, and the people that really want to get through the museum and go to the museum, it's got to walk from there down. And where you've got parking now, as you come down over the hill, and there's a place, and there's a fence up there, it used to be a roadway that went around the fort over towards looking it over, would like to see parking from there right over to the present parking lot for one vehicle to get in there, that line there. And you could still get out to the field if you wanted to, right there. Yeah. And I think that should be considered. I think we should make things as much as possible handy for elderly people to be able to get down and get through the museum and what have you. And I'm in favor of what you mentioned about the somebody that is kind of tied to the vehicle to be able to get a decent look at the ocean without looking around automobiles and what have you. I think that should be strived very earnestly so that they can get a view there, but probably somebody else will be in it when there, but maybe we could get some regulations in there.
Early on, Councilor Jordan, they did look at a couple of alternatives, and the issue with the one here is if you did it a direct, it'd be backing right out into the traffic, which does not meet any traffic design standards. It was also looked at maybe putting it up along here some. The problem is this is all permanently dedicated open space by the council and by ordinance, you know, which I suppose pertains to this big field. Secondly, in order to get the vehicles in and out here, one thing that was looked at was going up around the other way, and that does two things. It gets the traffic over near Delano Park, which, you know, wasn't looked at too kindly, you know, an area that is totally pedestrian-oriented now. The second problem it did do was relates to that is that a lot of people enjoy those pedestrian ways. So number one, you'll have the traffic near Delano Park, and number two, there's an awful lot of people that just like to walk in areas of the park without traffic flow.
Well,
you could, you know, if you, there's just not enough room otherwise to get the vehicles in and out of here.
I think if you, I know why I'm going around, I'm not in favor of going over to the park and making a trip around the rest of the fort, but I should think if you parked in the other direction, then they wouldn't be backing out into the street. They could park so many cars towards a bunker and so many towards a present parking lot. Then they'd have to back up and they would swing and be headed out and not be backing out into the street. I think it should be looked at again.
It's interesting. There are just an awful lot more cars there all the time. You know, if you Just, I've noticed in the last few years that it used to be just the lot, and now they're all parked all up along here now. They're all, about, you know, 5 or 6 cars squeezed into there. I've been parking there myself when I go down. But it's a mess, and, you know, something needs to be done. And this is the plan that the master plan was developed working with the Public Advisory Commission.
So we're supposed to say yes and not even comment on it because they're not going to take another look at it. Is that what you're telling me?
No, I don't think I'm... without directly challenging you, Bill, we did have the same discussion back when the master plan came forward, and I think you challenged it at that point, and you know, there wasn't a whole lot of support of your position, but you could have challenged it back then, and you did.
Yes, I even challenged this high school park when it was built, but now I see they want to see if they can encroach closer to the buildings with some parking.
Yeah, but you can reject the grant funds. You can, you can say this plan doesn't work. Go back and do another one. The only restriction for the grant is that we've got to get it started by October 1st. But you know, we could do more redesign. That's still in the cards, but it wouldn't be in the master plan, original plan.
Councilor Pearson.
Yes, I agree with Billy somewhat on getting some more parking closer, and I think that if you did have it perpendicular to the way it's depicted there, that would alleviate backing out into traffic. I also question the logic. If the big parking lot is going to be on the south side of that drawing, how come the sidewalk's on the opposite side? So they're going to walk from the big parking lot in the road down along the side?
Yeah, which there's going to be a crosswalk. Well, there's going to be, it isn't shown on this plan, but a sidewalk coming out of the central park, what's known as the central parking lot. Then there's going to be a crosswalk. The reason for that is you don't want the pedestrians out here amongst all the cars. You get them across the road, and then they're out of the traffic, and they're facing the traffic. Otherwise, you got them coming along here, and they're not...
Has it been considered to just make that circle bigger and have parallel parking instead of perpendicular parking, and then that way your sidewalk can skirt the whole circle and you don't have to cross any walks?
Well, you get into shoreline zoning then with, you know, if you expand out that parking lot, you know, you can't do it. You get into DEP review and everything else at that point. If you notice here, on the areas nearest the oceans, where we're backing away from the ocean instead of getting closer to it.
I'd agree with that. In fact, I hate seeing cars parked there because some people just like to come and see the ocean. You've got a string of cars there, you can't see anything anyways.
Yeah. Yeah, this is the question we're at the parking lot too. We'll also be recontoured so that, you know, right now you have a real high level, and then it drops off, and it'll be much more banked coming around there.
Councilor Cogshaw?
I think basically I'm in favor of having the parking lot where it is proposed by the master plan. I mean, a lot of work and effort went into it by a very dedicated group. And I think from the historical perspective, too, of people who go up into the Battery and they're looking out over the top of the Battery towards the lighthouse, towards the ocean, it's a similar view that was there back in 1941, instead of just looking at more cars. And it's out of sight from the lighthouse, so you're not looking from the lighthouse back towards the park and you're seeing a mass of cars either.
Thank you. Councilor Creelman, first, thank you.
Well, I agree with Councilor Cogshaw. I, for a couple of reasons, I think we're trying to balance here with the parking issue, the practical issues with the aesthetics of what we're creating here, and I just don't want a kind of a huge tailgating party out in front of the museum all the time. And I think if you do it with the cars closer, you're going to run the risk of that. Secondly, I just think that we made a commitment to the master plan, and this was exactly the way it was you know, portrayed on the master plan. At least I feel I voted for the master plan, and we all probably have seven opinions on where to put this tree or that tree. But, you know, when it comes down to brass tacks, we have a gorgeous document here that the group gave us, and I'm prepared to go with that particular plan.
Thank you. Councilor Chapel?
No, I agree with Councilor Creelman. I think that if we had been presented the entire picture tonight, we'd have had a different story, because I more or less agree with Councilor Jordan on this particular thing that I look at. All I'm seeing is that, and the museum, which I know where it is, and the gift shop, which I know where it is, and there's no parking right near it. But then if I move back a little bit, if I had that road put in there, and the crosswalk, and the sidewalks, and where the parking is, and had the big picture, I think I would be clearer. I don't think that map is clear at all, is what we're trying to do.
Do you have a copy of the master plan?
I've got it, but I haven't got it with me tonight.
Okay. We did receive it in the packet. It was not easy to read in the packet.
No, I'm just saying for a presentation to the council, it would be much nicer to expand right now and put the other things on that particular map right there so we can see it. Because it's not that far away, the parking lot that Mr. McGovern is talking about. In fact, you can cross the road, and it's nowheres at all. It isn't any more than walking out to your car here. No, no, it isn't. You know where your stop sign is? That's not far. It might be for if you're a little older, Billy.
I'm looking out for the elderly people.
I'm sure Councilor Chapel appreciates your concern. Look at me.
I was going to move that we do this, but I don't know now.
We don't have a motion. I have some more information to put forth before we get into a motion.
I think we should quit right now.
Comes over and does anything vicious here. I was able to contact a couple of members of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee last night, just wanting to touch base with them and get a feel from them about this. And the conversations I had with those two particular members made me feel glad that we are going to be sitting down and talking with the members of our boards and commissions. I think, you know, I had good conversations with them. They shared some concerns with me, and I do have a concern that, you know, sometimes a lot of expectations are put on their budget. And then I did receive a copy of the letter that the manager had sent out to that commission. I was envisioning their budget being drastically reduced by a $20,000 contribution from it. However, as the manager indicated, I don't know if you indicated this or not, but in the memo it says that with a $20,000 contribution from the Fort Williams Fund, that fund is still left with a $41,000. And with that, I knew we had appropriated $30,000 into that fund for the coming year. There was carryover money, which I had forgotten about, quite frankly. That gave me a better feeling about taking the $20,000 out of the Fort Williams Fund. I really didn't want to decimate that fund, and I think that's more or less the feeling they had sometimes recently, something we can touch on when we do meet with them. So that, as I said, made me feel better about the proposal that had been put forward to us. I do agree with the comments that were made that we can proceed with the master plan. Having been in the design field, I know how many permutations of this design had to be gone through and sketched out before this design was finalized. You looked at a lot of different aspects, and I know a lot of the comments that were made tonight had to have been considered when this design was being created. Having said that, I would like a motion at this point.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? Okay, and the motion is to appropriate $40,000 to match the state money, taking $20,000 from the Fort Williams Fund and $20,000 from the Portland Headlight Museum Fund. Okay. All those in favor? All opposed? Councilor Jordan, 6-1. Item number 31 is to consider authorizing the acceptance of bids for two town-owned lots and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. These two lots, one of them is on High Bluff Road, which is a very wet area, very mucky. There's some drainage lines along it, which we would retain easements over. number of people in the neighborhood has expressed strong concern over the years and about the condition of the lot, and they'd like to be a little more proactive in maintaining it and keeping it in much more cleaner shape. The second lot is up on Trundy Road, and is right near where those paper streets were that the council looked at. It is an area that the public does not have access to. It's there's no public way to get there other than across the paper streets. It has no municipal use. It's not really strong for conservation purposes except for maintaining the view from Trundy Road. However, the town doesn't have an interest to go in and to cut it down for one family's, essentially one family's view. So it's proposed that both these lots go up to bid with notices to the abutters, and that we put a minimum value on the Trundy Road lot of $3,100 and a minimum value on the High Bluff lot of $1,000. The Trundy Road is the assessed value. The High Bluff Road, the assessor had $18,900 on it. No idea where that one comes from. I hate to say. It does not appear at all realistic for any use that the lot could ever be used for. The Conservation Commission did provide a recommendation that both lots be sold. They suggested certain conditions. As you can see from my memo to you, I did not exactly agree with the conditions. I didn't discuss it today with the chairman of the Conservation Commission. And on the issue of the High Bluff Road lot, it was his feeling that what I was recommending was in keeping with what they wanted. I just went about it differently, but it was in keeping with what the Conservation Commission wanted, which is, you know, essentially that if anything was done there, that it be done by the wetlands regulations in effect. And that's what I was proposing, rather than doing it by deed restriction, the wetlands provisions ought to be in place. And on the other lot, the issue, you know, it's one you could debate all night, but it's, which we're not suggesting, and that is, if someone acquires an adjacent lot, can you state that it doesn't change the setbacks? You know, if someone wanted to extend out a porch in the back, I frankly didn't see a whole lot of municipal interest or public purpose in restricting, you know, the folks if they wanted to pick up this little piece in back of them, and if they wanted to put a little thing on the back of their home. So I disagreed with that recommendation and didn't discuss it with the chairman of the Conservation Commission. He indicated to the effect that it wasn't really an issue, that they did put that condition in there, but once he heard my viewpoint, he wasn't too excited about it.
What, your viewpoint?
No, he said it just wasn't a big deal.
The whole issue.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry. I'm sorry.
That's fine. Thank you, Mr. McGovern. We do appreciate the Conservation Commission having looked at this and forwarded their comments to us. I know that's how it operates in some of the other communities as well. Could I have a motion on this before we have discussion?
So moved.
Second, with a couple of comments, if I may.
Yes, Councilor Jordan.
I agree with the managers 100% as far, especially as far as the Shore Acre law. And if they, a butter happened to pick that up and wanted to get it something to his place, I think he should be allowed to do it and not have to go before two or three boards to get approval. And it would be added to his lot, and to me it would be a much better setup. As far as High Bluff one, that seems to be quite a wet area, and is that large enough to require DEP approval for them to get involved in a small lot like that? I wouldn't think so.
No.
It's too small for DEP.
No, but the issue I had with it was, you know, if they wanted to fill a very small section of it or alter a small section of it to make it flow better, and, you know, to clean up. Right now, it's a swamp. It's a brackish swamp. That, you know, I would prefer that the planning board be allowed to consider an application if it's something that would improve the lot, and decide if it is in the best interest and it is in keeping with the ordinances, rather than doing it by deed restriction. And Jack Roberts, when I spoke to him, agreed with that.
Okay. No problem with that.
Thank you. Councilor Cogshaw?
If on the lot that's in Shore Acres, the abutter does buy it, I think it would be in his best interest to have that deeded as one lot, and then he wouldn't have to worry about any setbacks or anything like that. We shouldn't change the ordinances just because he owns the abutting lot. He would have to get a variance if he was going to get into the setbacks like anyone else, unless he... So maybe if he's the one to buy it, it should be a strong recommendation for him to be able to make best use of it, is to have it in the registry as one lot. And my other question is, when we were talking about abandoning these paper roads, there was some question as to the ownership of those particular lots, and for some reason, I don't recall being told that was owned by the town. I might have had a different view. Did he say it was at that time?
That's right.
Okay. That's what I'm trying to clarify. On the High Bluff Road area, Michael, is that considered a buildable lot, square footage-wise? It's over 10,000 square feet.
Yeah, but no way you can do that wetland.
Okay. But there is also another little tiny town-owned lot that is bound. Lot number 22, do you know what that is? Maybe that one should be put up for sale, too.
Which map, Phyllis?
It's lot number 22, which just follow the property line straight down to the bottom, and it says town 2000.
I'm sorry, on the High Bluff or on
Yeah.
High Bluff.
High Bluff. That funny-looking piece on the other side?
Yeah.
It's
the bottom of 23.
Yeah. I think there's a drainage structure that's on that lot.
That's why we own it.
I believe so. That's my recollection. I'll check it again. But that's my recollection, is there's some sort of a drainage structure there. It's a real wet area. It runs down the back there and then connects in with, like, right near where the sewer pump station is on Oak Crest Road. In fact, there was a suit there once, even, amongst the neighbors in back of Rockwell.
Yes,
sir. Okay, Councilor Crowley?
On the High Bluff parcel, in talking to one of the abutters, it appears that area actually is used for skating purposes in the winter. There's enough water in that to freeze over and actually become a quasi pond if you dodge the stumps and a variety of other hazardous stories. Could that, and you have to remind me on our zoning ordinance, could that be dredged a bit and made into a safer pond because of the square footage there? Could that be made into actually a pond for both aesthetics as well as skating purposes in the winter?
I'm not a geologist, I'm not an engineer. Some things would persuade me to say perhaps yes, but then that runs into other problems that everyone down there can't wait for it to dry out. To get rid of the mosquitoes, it's a real bug thing. So if you improve it one way, you cause a problem another.
No, I was just, that may be true, but I was just wondering if it is, zoning-wise, if it is possible to turn that into a safer area.
Zoning-wise, yes.
Right now, I would say it's a liability for kids to be skating on that when it freezes over in the winter. It's a liability to the town.
Yeah, any activity that happens on town property has the potential of being a liability even if it's a good.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Okay, we do have a motion to authorize the acceptance of bids and the minimum prices that have been stated. All those in favor?
Let's go.
7-0, thank you. Item 32, to consider a proposed policy for foreclosed commercial property to take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Several months ago, the council got into a discussion on foreclosed commercial property and said you wanted something to come back to you on it. This is a suggestion fairly open about it. I did ask town attorney to look into the issue, have his response. And basically, what this recommendation is that any commercial property we foreclosed on from August 1st on, or really from this point on, would be sold at public auction with a minimum price to be established by the council. Prior to the auction, we would do a quiet title proceeding. This would mean that we would go through the whole process to clear the title so that we would get the benefit of the maximum value of it instead of someone else trying to quiet the title afterward and getting the maximum value. We would take out the risk, and you know, we would do that through the quiet title action ourselves. It's a way of maximizing the town's profit of the situation. The previous owner of the property would have no special redemption rights for the property other than the fact they could participate in the auction. The exact rules of the procedure for the auction would be developed by the town attorney, all of the, you know, the things you see in a legal ad. We do have two properties that were foreclosed upon at this point, and it's recommended that we essentially follow the policy up above. However, since this is a new policy and these were foreclosed upon prior to the development of the policy, that you give them a period within which they could redeem the property. And whatever that period is whatever the period the council want to set. Commercial property, there was an issue of, you know, when we're talking about commercial property, I took a stab at a definition. I'm not totally happy with it, and I understand others aren't as well.
Yes.
The stab I took was any parcel with a building upon it, upon which the property owner does not personally reside as of the date of foreclosure. And again, you know, are they going to move in just in the date of foreclosure? You can play all sorts of games with that. However, this policy would not apply to land use for area used predominantly for agricultural purpose, nor would it include any single-family residences. And that's the case if you have a mom-and-pop type store and the owner lives upstairs, you know, in a single unit. The whole thrust of this is, you know, people living in homes has never been the town's position. You want to throw people out of their homes. And, you know, this would exist. It would continue to exist. This is a stab at something for your consideration, and whatever you'd like to do with it would be fine.
Okay. Now, I appreciate your responding to our concerns about this issue. This is something that the council had asked the manager to get back to us on. This is the response. Could I have a motion, please, and then we'll have discussion.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Comments? Councilor Pearson.
Chairman McLaughlin. I'm just still dismayed that this has taken so long to come to to come to pass. As I recall, I think the two properties, one of them in particular, could have been foreclosed on a year ago. Is that correct? And this was brought up to us 6 months after that time, so it's been now closer to 18 months since this first came to our attention. And I'm just amazed at how long it's taken. And I just want to bring that on the table and express my displeasure by the lack of progress on this particular, and particularly with properties concerned.
What two properties are you have in mind that not aware of exactly what they are?
I think one in particular is on Shore Road. Are we allowed to
sell the information?
It's Burgess property, I believe, which now houses Basics.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not as well aware of the other one, but that one in particular. It's just because I know it's been batted back and forth for quite a while here.
Second one we just foreclosed on about a month ago, which is the old Andy's IGA store up here owned by Robert Kimball out of Massachusetts.
Other comments?
Michael, was this drafted by the attorney or by you?
No, can't you tell?
Well, it's just
yes, it was done by
you. You wrote a letter to him and he wrote back to you,
yeah.
But he didn't include a draft of something, which I think is what he should have done. But are we saying, are we going to be approving this particular format? Do we give you more direction? Do we give you direction on the current places that are foreclosed and a procedure to bring those to auction?
Yeah, you'd want to insert some dates in.
We have some choices, Councilor Cottrell, on how to deal with this. We can set the overall policy. We can deal just with the policy to address the two properties that we know have been foreclosed on. And we can roll those together, or we can separate them. And we can do something about this definition, which I saw you as uncomfortable with as I was. Or we can send it back and have it drafted legally. The majority of the council is not comfortable with what is before us this evening. Do you have any?
I would like to have something prepared by the attorney that we can approve and know that it will meet all the legal tests.
Okay. Has this been reviewed at all by the attorney?
It was in the packet that was mailed to him last Tuesday. He informed me he would review it. He hasn't commented positively or negatively. I don't know how much review he's given it. He said he'd look over the packet. I didn't speak to him last Wednesday, I think it was the first.
You want it specifically reviewed by the attorney, Councilor Cottrell?
Yes, I do. Because in previous situations, he said unless we had specific concerns, he would look it over and not make any further comment. But I want to know if this is the best way to go.
That's fine with me. What you may do is give an indication this evening whether or not this is the direction that you want, the general outline, and also to what date you want to insert. And when they draft something up.
I think we're going the right way. I just want to make sure it's done.
Any other thoughts along those lines? People feeling that it should go back to the attorney? Councilor Krillman?
Yes, I agree with Councilor Cogsell. I'd like to see something in the legalese that is part of our world these days to make a decision on. But I'd also like to have a recommendation in terms of filling in those particular dates. I mean, there's no sense reinventing the wheel. This kind of ordinance for commercial property, I'm sure Portland has one in existence, and I'd like to get a sense, even though it's public policy and it's up to us as to when we want to make those dates, I'd like to get a sense as to what other communities have seen as reasonable in terms of the time frame for something that's already in our possession.
Yeah, this is just, other communities aren't facing this issue because they're not changing their policies. This paragraph is simply a transition, mm-hmm. and the date recommended is December 31, 1992. In essence, you would tell the Burgesses or whoever the corporate name is, and you would tell Mr. Kimball that they had until December 31st, or otherwise, whatever the attorney drafts in paragraph one would be in existence.
But I mean, what if we don't get this thing on the docket again, until December?
We'll have it on the docket.
If you wanted to look at the attorney, it'll be on your, particularly after Councilor Pearson's comments, it'll definitely be on your agenda next month.
All right, that's reasonable.
I agree with Councilors Cogsell and Krillman that we are going in the right direction. I think the 5-month time frame should be sufficient. Well, it was 5 months from August 1st. Yeah, we'll meet August 10th, just over 4.5 months. Do you have other comments? I'd like to hear them.
Yeah, we're mumbling over here because our feeling, I don't know, collectively is that 5 months does seem to be a bit of a short period of time in this recessionary period. People are short. The circumstances of why we're foreclosing. I just wonder, in other communities, I mean, when this happens, is there a year's grace period? Is there 2 years? If it's 5 months, it seems like a short time just off the cuff.
I'm not sure a lot of other communities go through this. No. Transition situation right now, in these economic times. I don't know of any other communities going through this right now. The other communities I work with and mm-hmm. confer with.
I could explain the tax process,
please.
Okay.
The taxes that these properties were foreclosed upon were assessed. A couple of years ago, They then, a lien went on, they were due in October and May of a certain year. The lien was placed in July of that same year. They then had 18 months until a year from the following January to pay the taxes. So, you know, the taxes for the original October, of which both of these, at least I know the Burgess property was for sure, was at least 28 months overdue. And if you take Councilor Pearson's comment, if it's been a year, that's they're at least 40 months overdue. And notices have been sent constantly to the Burgesses. They don't even claim their certified mail when we send out the notices.
Well, you're convincing me to become unmerciful.
I don't think, you know, knowing the history of these two properties,
yeah,
knowing the opportunities that they've had to sell them and have ignored, I don't feel that we'll be overly generous in the amount of time that we give them to redeem.
Thank you. Councilor Pearson?
Just a clarification, the rumblings on this part of the side were that 5 months seems to be more than adequate time, and I'd like to see that even less. It's just, it baffles me that you can go for 2 years, and this will drag it out to 3+ years, and not have any action other than notices. That boggles my mind. I'd like to do that with my taxes.
Well, this has been the town's policy since 1765, mm-hmm, or whenever tax liens began. And I think you ought to. I think it's wise that the attorney look at it when you're changing the policy that's been in effect for 25 years, 27 years. You might want to give it the time it deserves.
When I discussed this with the manager this afternoon and was brought up to date on the history, I felt that the 5 months was ample. I don't think it needs to be any more than 5 months. If we want to lessen it, then it'd be fine. I'm saying nods to the 5 months at this point. If the attorney recommends something, a shorter time frame, I think that would be...
The attorney doesn't have any expertise on this. It's a political judgment.
Okay.
Council ought to make it.
All right. I'd like a consensus indication on the December 31st.
That's fine.
Yeah, knowing the history now, it's more reasonable.
Councilor Pearson, I know you're not pleased with that. It's better than later, I think. Okay, 5 months. And I think you're going in the right direction with this definition. We'll have it improved, I'm sure.
And if anyone...
The points are...
I'm going to be sending a letter to the town attorney tomorrow saying that we need this back by X date in order to be on next agenda. If anyone has any suggestions on the definition of commercial property, let me know before you go.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Councilor Dalbec, would you consider withdrawing your motion?
I'll withdraw the motion.
And who is the second?
I'll withdraw the second.
Okay. I would entertain a new motion reflecting this discussion.
I'd move the revised proposal.
And I'll second it.
Okay. Thank you. We will expect this on our August agenda. Thank you. Any further comment? All those in favor? Opposed? 6-1, Councilor Pearson. Thank you. Item number 33 is to consider referring to the Planning and Zoning Board's responsibility for reviewing setback variance policies for single-family dwellings and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, this is still quite a ways off, but it's not too late to get started on it. It's going to take some time. The Conservation Commission has expressed some interest in working on it, so I would recommend that...
Excuse me.
Oh, setback variances?
I thought that we were closer than a long way.
I'm confused. This is item number 30. It's item number 33, but it's listed as item number 35. I'm sorry.
It's all right.
As you can see, the Maine Municipal Association, the Maine Townsman, pointed out that there is the opportunity to change some definitions within the setback variance requirements. What I'd suggest is you refer this to the ordinance committee and have them ask for the zoning board, zoning planning board's opinion as well.
And
see if there's anything you want to do. Yeah, if you'd like.
That's what the item is.
That'd be fine.
Okay. Well, these things happen. I'd like a motion, please.
I'll move that we refer this to the ordinance committee.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan.
I'd like to.
Okay, discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 34 is to consider requesting the planning board, the conservation commission, and the town manager to provide recommendations on the disposition of paper streets and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
This is the one I, Yando was playing a few minutes ago, and the numbers are wrong at the top, and it was in the wrong order in my packet as well. I'm sorry. I think this is quite explanatory. It was something we borrowed from neighboring communities, South Portland. Their former associate corporation council looked at this memo. I would recommend that you do request the planning board, conservation commission, and the staff to begin to work on this process and to provide you recommendations on it by the end of this year.
So moved.
Second that.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 35 is to consider requesting the ordinance committee to review proposed revisions to the comprehensive plan and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, there aren't any materials on this, but when the state commented initially on our comprehensive plan, they said a certain few additions need to be made to conform to state requirements. Secondly, we also need to update it to put the 1990 census data in. What I would suggest that this ought to be a high priority because once we do it, we'll be able to print up the comprehensive plan and rapidly disseminate it to all those who are interested. And I think it'll be paid a lot more attention to once it's in a fairly good presentable document. So I would urge you to refer this to the ordinance committee, and I will be working with the planner to encourage that this be a very high priority project because it is focusing. The fact there isn't a good comprehensive plan document, it isn't getting the attention that it deserves.
Thank you. Councilor Coggeshall, what does the time frame for your committee look like for dealing with this?
We could probably start on it if our planner has information in September.
Okay, so we could see this back by the end of the year. Is that the time frame?
In this comprehensive plan, we're also supposed to be including information on a town center plan, aren't we? Isn't there special money that's been granted to us for that?
Well, see, that's the whole issue that's here, and is until we make these changes, you can't get implementation grants, and you can't continue to get the state funds unless you respond to their comments. So, yeah, it all.
So we're doing that so we can.
Yeah. Exactly.
And then get funding.
And then we'll get. Then we
so
can
the
get.
The plan itself may not be complete by the end of the year, but close to it, depending upon adoption of the town center.
Yeah, but I don't think you can keep. No, there's going to be some other report that keeps coming along.
Oh, I'm sure.
Thank you. I'd like a motion, please.
I move that we forward the update of the ordinance, comprehensive plan to the ordinance committee.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0.
Report by January 1st, 1993.
You're one of those committee members. Item number 36, to consider proposed amendments to the general assistance ordinance and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yeah, this is really another technical amendment to conform with state law, and I'd recommend you set it for public hearing. It has to do with recipients of supplemental security income and the documents that they need to sign when they apply for general assistance.
I would move that the amendment to the general assistance ordinance be set to public hearing on August 10th, 1992 at 7:30.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Thank you. That concludes the regular items on our agenda this evening. Are there any citizens who wish to discuss items not on the agenda?
Seeing none, we will move on, and I would like a motion for adjournment, please.
So moved.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Thank you, 7-0.
How's the conference room, Deb? Is it available?
Thank you.